To do for people who not consent in a smart city, what would you do to people who do not consent with having their data tracked?
Right. Oh, you
Deal
mean
with
an
them in a
invasion of
normal city.
privacy?
Force them,
That's a valid point, right? So for
if you
all these.
forcibly take a gun against the head and say we will track your data, that's not a smart city, that's an authoritarian city.
No, Agastya, in the video it was stated that they are taking surveys from the people, the
Yeah,
citizens,
but
if
they
they
could
want
also, like, for
Hashtag make
example,
clouds rain.
I think that would
Guys,
depend from country to
the echo
country,
talks in the
country to.
next room. It can hear us. It's tracking everything I'm saying, and it's sending it all the way to the
I also have an
CIA.
Alexa near me. I had a good.
Guys, it's
Okay.
tracking you.
Okay,
I
is
have to be the one to
everybody.
break the conspiracy.
Okay, is everybody done? Should we just discuss the quiz?
No,
Yes,
I'm on
Aditi.
question number 12. I still have a few
I'm at
questions.
10.
Okay.
Oh, my man,
Okay, fine. Take a few more minutes and then we'll discuss.
not done. Agastya was
Like,
talking
in
too
some
much.
questions, like, other three options and two answers are, like, so
Yes.
bad that you don't even need to read the third one.
Let's
Yeah,
make
okay.
clouds rain
Almost all of these
automatically.
questions have one very
Oh,
wrong
you could
answer
make it so
and
that
two
you can
dumb
make.
answers.
I do have one idea. These questions are pretty good.
You can have tripwire activated windows, or using a pressure sensor, you can use windows. So if anyone tries to lock pick the door without permission, there can be maybe
There
a
can be an
bunch of
alarm in the
commands
nearest
there.
police station, right? There can be an
How about
alarm.
nobody
Wait, don't we
thinks
already
like
have this?
criminals?
Yes, we already
Don't we
have
already
such
have
systems.
this?
Yes, we
How
already.
about nobody thinks like criminals and whoever does dies? That can.
We call
Ma'am, in
that
15th question, I have a
You can't
question.
punish
We
people
all
for
know
their thoughts, right?
who's gonna try to establish a
They would have to
dystopian
be
nation,
reading
right?
people's thoughts all the time and punishing people
Telekinesis.
based on
Also,
their thoughts would
if
be
you do
wrong.
that, isn't that considered a totalitarian government?
Yeah. That's the definition of the.
Depending on what someone thinks, you're going to decide what happens. You have total control over their lives, whether they live and or die.
Ma'am,
Hey, Sarim, yeah.
like in the 15th question part C, they can stop lightning. Does that mean the lighting, or does that mean literal lightning with the thunder?
They mean lightning.
Okay, I need to look at the quiz. Does it say lightning?
Yes, ma'am, it says lightning.
Okay, question number.
There's a question with an option that the sensors will detect if air is dry and then make the clouds rain.
Yeah, that's what I was saying.
Sarim, which question are
Command
you talking about? Question
15 part C.
15, part C.
Big, big
Okay,
concern.
there is a spelling mistake there. It's for
Okay,
lighting.
ma'am. Okay, ma'am.
Okay, you can't control the natural lightning, right?
Ma'am, then how can you control
Can,
clouds?
but you can't technically control natural lightning by installing a rod that's able to transport electricity to the ground where.
That won't be natural lightning. That's like saying because
That'd
we are
be.
natural,
It
what we
would
made
be
it is
natural
natural.
lightning. So when lightning strikes,
This is
yeah, you
natural
could capture
then.
that energy and do something useful with that. We have artificial rains, and if you have seen the Geostorm movie, remember they are. Created a setup to control the weather, but okay, it's a
Yeah.
fictional movie. That system isn't there yet, requires a lot of work. Maybe someday we'll be there.
Ma'am, I'm
Maybe
uploading
some
it.
millennia.
Okay, so Raman, which question are you at right now?
Ma'am, I'm on 8.
Ninth.
It.
8. Okay, fine.
Ma'am, I finished, so should I send you the answers?
No, it's okay. Just keep it with you. We'll discuss each question one by one. Okay, should we start our discussion in 2 minutes?
Miss, just a few minutes.
Yes. I'm done.
Same here.
Okay, everybody is done with the first 10 questions, right? Maybe you could do the we could do the last 5 questions together.
I have an idea. How about for everyone who's done over 10 questions, we can discuss the 10 questions, and by then they'll be done with the other 5.
Yeah, we can do that. I think everybody is done with the first 10 questions, right? Farzad, Raman, have you finished 10 questions?
Ma'am, you can just wait 2 more minutes and everybody will be done with all the 15 questions.
Yeah, let's just wait.
Ma'am, let's wait till 2:20, like 3 more.
Okay,
minutes.
Fine. Done. Okay.
Miss, I'm posting my answers on Google Classroom.
Fine. Okay.
Ma'am already uploaded and turned in.
Okay. So how many of you did watch the videos about smart cities?
Me.
Okay.
I think everyone did. The questions are based on those videos.
Yeah.
I watched the smart cities. I even took notes because I thought it would be a more complex quiz.
Okay.
This was a fun quiz.
Yeah, but this covers the basic understanding and we'll be discussing each question.
I handed it in 3 minutes late.
Okay, that's good. So fine, then we are ready for more complex quizzes, right? We'll do a more complex one next time. Maybe we could do a programming quiz next time. So like it would not be like, you know, asking you to write programs, but in the form of a quiz where I give you maybe a code snippet and ask you about the output of the program or the value of a variable at a, you know, when the execution is at a particular point, those kind of questions. Fine, we can do that. Okay, Raman, so how many questions have you done?
Ma'am, 9.
Okay, that's good. We can start our discussion. And when we discuss the question 10, you can do it with everyone at that time. Okay. So I'll share the quiz here. Let me share the screen. Okay, there's a disclaimer that the questions in the quiz are based on ideas and vision about smart cities and smart home that will be implemented in future. So, you know, most of the questions, the use cases that you see in the questions, they may or may not be realistic in the current time. First question, what does a smart home mean? Is it a home?
Shall we answer alternately?
You can put your answers on the chat window or you can just speak.
We can just discuss.
I already put all my answers in chat.
Option A.
Okay.
Is
it a home where smart looking people live? Like Tom Cruise, Hrithik Roshan?
No, it's B, obviously.
Yes.
Is it a home where mentally smart people like Einstein or Elon Musk or Shatun.
Yeah, Einstein's grave is put there.
No. Einstein's grave is the most smartest.
But
I actually live nearby where Einstein's brain is stored and where he used to live.
It will be D, right?
I'm a D because all the others are pretty stupid.
Is it a home which looks smart like the Antilla in Mumbai?
Yes.
One you see in the image?
I'm totally correct. Like, so correct, I can't even argue.
Okay, so most of the devices of our homes have Wi-Fi connectivity, right? They can communicate with each other and they can also connect to a centralized IT infrastructure running in companies' data centers. And then a lot of interesting services can be delivered. Let's discuss a use case here before we move on to the next question. I am going to annotate here. All of you are aware of the wearable devices, right? I'm sure most of you have a wearable device.
Yes.
Like those watches, Apple watches.
Yes. So we have wearable devices and we also have technology to a level where the sensor, the chip can be inside your body, measuring the parameters of your body. And this measurement could be sent to a centralized system. Okay, so your smart devices, the wearable devices, are capable of measuring few things like your body temperature, maybe your blood pressure, your heart rate, and so on. the chip inside your body will be capable of measuring few more things. And these measurements, so you have your wearable device or the chip inside your body, it's a small device measuring things. And this data is sent to your phone, right? Most of you have experienced that. Yes. So, and your phone could be sending this data to a centralized server, which could be living on cloud again to ensure that this is highly available and this is never down. So it could be on an Amazon cloud, a Google cloud, a Microsoft cloud, somewhere. Okay. So all this data is collected here. And this data in this centralized system collects data of all the people across a city, maybe across a country, maybe more than one country. Using this data, we could be having algorithms here, AI algorithms here, which learn from the data. Okay, so we have enough technology on this centralized server to not only store the data, it's going to be huge amount of data. Imagine measuring all the body parameters of people in a city or in a country, and that measurement taken each day of the year. So for one person itself, it's a lot of data. And then you're doing this data collection for each person in the city. Yes.
Ma'am, there is some type of discussion about pizza going on in the chat.
Okay.
Apparently, Ved went to Princeton and ate pizza and came back.
Why not go to the local Pizza Hut?
Where did pizza come from in this discussion?
Ma'am, no.
He went to camp to Princeton, ate pizza, didn't study and came back.
Oh my God.
Simplified discussion.
Thank you.
Okay, his body parameter measurements were so good that he felt like celebrating it. So he celebrated it with a pizza. Okay, so see, this is how the system is implemented. You need to understand it at a high level. I'll not go into the nitty-gritties and fine details of this implementation because that would require more knowledge about how software systems work. But I'm sure you can understand a high-level architecture. So we'll just have this discussion about the high-level architecture that will also, make the AI learning more interesting. You will know exactly how it is being implemented for all these interesting use cases to work in real life. Like when you talk to Alexa or, get a recommendation on Netflix, all these things, it just feels like it's so simple that, this was a use case, it just happened, but it doesn't happen like magic. It's not like in the Iron Man movie, he just asks Jarvis to do something and then Jarvis magically does something. To have that use case actually perform and, that thing being in action in real time, a lot of pieces work together in coordination. And this is a sample use case that I'm explaining to you. So consider this as a wearable device or a chip inside a man's body, measuring his body parameters and then sending that data to his phone. His phone is connected to Wi-Fi. So his phone is sending data through Wi-Fi to a central system that resides on cloud, let's say Amazon cloud. Okay. So that this is highly available. Like, if electricity goes off in a data center, all that data is still available. So you on cloud, you have measures to, you can plan for disaster recovery. You can plan for making things highly available. So all this data is stored. So we have enough hardware and software here to enable storage of such huge amounts of data. And then, so this data is collected for millions of people over years, each day. This data is being used to analyze and interpret information from it. And there could be algorithms sitting here making use of this data, learning from this data. One example could be that there's an algorithm that is learning from the data, and then it knows that if a patient's, there were like 35,000 cases of organ failure throughout the country, okay, and whose data is available in the central system. So this AI algorithm uses that data, it learns from that data, and now it knows that, you know, these people who went through the organ failure and they couldn't be saved, just before they went through this condition, their body parameters were in this range. A month before, their body parameters were somewhat like this. So if we are able to detect and, you know, measure and analyze the body parameters of someone. Yes.
Ma'am.
Yeah, sorry.
So this can also help, like save lives, because like analyzing data from somebody who got like suffered from a heart attack, like right. What happened in their body right just before that.
Exactly.
So if somebody else is getting that sensation or that kind of illness, so the computer can tell the person that you should go to the nearest hospital or something, so that it doesn't affect him to like such a great extent like it would do usually.
Yes, Sarim, that's exactly the point. So from this, the learning from this data is that you could, you know, save people from landing into an organ failure or, you know, similar such threats. You already know, you know, once you are taking that measurements every day, the moment the measurements are in a potential threat range, then you send a notification to this person's doctor, because, you know, everything is available in this central system. We know this person's doctor's details are also available here. His emergency contact is also available here. So the moment such a potential threat is identified by the AI algorithms, a notification, again, that notification goes over Wi-Fi to, let's say, his doctor or the hospital where, you know, that where he's registered with, he's put a doctor's name or a hospital's name in his emergency contacts. This person gets a notification that your patient is under a potential threat, and he could just send a list of medication to this person, respond through network, or maybe he could just, you know, schedule an appointment and see that patient. So this is one use case where, you know, it's just data and learning from data that is helping us save lives. And in one of the questions, I think I have stated that, you know, would it be better for the notification to be sent directly to doctor from his phone? Should all this data directly go to doctor? Do you think that would be a good thing to do, a wise thing to do? Instead of this data
being lagging, I'm still on question number one.
Okay, are you able to hear me fine? Yeah, we're still on the question number one.
Yes, ma'am. But
Okay. So my question is, see, we are making all these measurements for all the patients, okay? Would it be a wise thing to do to send this data about this patient directly to his or her doctor?
I think they should encrypt it.
Ma'am, it depends if the situation is serious, because like the doctors would have a lot in their hands.
But then, yes, that's right. But who will decide whether the situation is serious?
If a patient is dying, then
somebody who is either in risk of getting an extremely bad disease or has an extremely bad condition.
I think they should prioritize by the person who is currently dying or something.
Yes, all that is right, but my question is that, you know, this wearable device is doing the measurement all the time. So should this data from the wearable device directly go to the doctor?
I think it should go to like some place first, and then from there it should go to the doctor.
Exactly.
Yes, ma'am.
this doctor is not just, you know, he would be having more than one patient, right? He would be looking after many other people in addition to this person. So if, you know, if each of their measurable device sends data directly to the doctor is going to be overwhelmed. What will he do with that amount of data? He's just going to quit at some point.
He's going to say, let them die.
Nobody, I mean...
No one says that. No one says that.
The doctor will if you slam work at
him. No, I'm sure he wouldn't say that. But then
say, let them die.
No, he wouldn't say that. But he would be overwhelmed, right? The doctors have their own life.
Which is why we should have a branch of doctors taking care of one patient at a time and moving on to the next.
Yeah, but then
there are more patients than doctors.
Okay, in this case, but aren't we overloading the doctor? If we are sending all the data to the doctor, then we are expecting the doctor to not only have medical expertise, but he should also be able to look at all those tables of data, analyze it, interpret information from it. Is that...
We can put an AI thing to do it.
Exactly. That is why we have this central system, because we want the doctor to do what he's best at. And we don't want his time wasted in things which can be done by a machine.
Like, yeah, the machine can run the data from the wearable device into simple sentences.
Yes, so there are many things. So we want humans to do more important things. So things which can be done by a machine, we let the machines do those.
Yes, sir. Our human time is more valuable than machine time.
So we'll do more important things.
Yeah. Okay. The machines, they can analyze something like which is very serious. They can send it to the doctor.
Because then they'll do it with zero errors.
Right. So
not necessarily.
Not compulsory.
Yeah, but if you train it, it will.
It will.
A machine can break.
You have trained it, tested it enough. Yes.
Since we're on the topic, in the post-apocalyptic thought, like, as if it's a game like, I don't know, Detroit Become Human, where we fully lean on robots, what if we start mistreating them?
They don't have feelings.
Then
what everybody fears will come true.
Even if a robot, is a very smart robot, most of them have been coded and have learned to do incredibly specific things.
And robots won't be angry and won't bring on apocalypto.
Yeah, unless we create a robot that's specifically made to be angry.
Yeah, so right now they just do their job without any emotion, right?
Yeah, they don't use the words like you're bad and all that. They just take the keywords like wash the dishes.
Right.
They'll just follow keywords. They won't take the rest of the sentence.
Yes.
So, ma'am, I have done and sent the answers to you.
Okay, thank you, Raman. Okay, so fine. Coming back to this discussion. So here, sending all this data to a centralized system would definitely could help save lives. And it also makes doctor's job easier. He can just focus on his work. You know, whenever a patient really needs attention, then he can give attention to that patient. And maybe, if either he fixes an appointment or just sends the list of medications required, the things to be done to a nurse or directly to this person. So in the form of implementation, okay, this is the high level architecture. This is what happens. But if you go more granular, so look at this. So, essentially we want this doctor to get alerts only when his attention is required. So why do we need all the system? Why do we need the wearable device or the chip inside his body to send details to the phone and then this phone communicating to a central system and central system communicating to this? Can we get rid of this part? If not, why? Can we just have this chip do all the job and send alerts to doctor as and when required?
Yes, unlike humans,
AI can fail miserably, leading to dire consequences. Now, I'm saying we can, depending on the situation, I say we let different people handle it. If it's a problem that
I think we should let AI handle it.
Okay, no, in this discussion, I'm saying can we eliminate this portion of the architecture?
Which portion, auntie, can you repeat?
So this is the wearable device. The wearable device or the chip inside the body of the patient sending data to phone, then phone sending data to a central system. This central system has algorithms, stores all the data and sends alert to the patient's doctor as and when required, only when it's required.
And what about directly sending the chip's information to the doctor?
Yes, that's my question.
Like if you can code it in such a way that it shortens like the algorithm and it doesn't require like such. Like even nowadays, like the watch, we wear the fitness watches, they send the information to our phone. It can do the same to the doctor's phone.
Right, so
probably a lot of irrelevant data.
Not necessarily. We can simplify it and magnify it to such an extent that it doesn't give unnecessary data.
But you still need a device for that. You know, the central device which has an algorithm to simplify that.
Okay, so the key problems are going to be one, this device or chip, either it's a wearable or a chip inside the patient, has data only about that patient, right? It does not have the data of all the people in the city. That's one. So whatever, even if this was chip was big enough to have the storage and processing power to actually have the algorithms to do some processing and send alert to the doctor, then also, you know, it won't be able to do a good job because it does not have all the data. Number two, this chip, you know, you don't want a heavy chip to be installed in your body, right? If you want that chip to hold a large number of data and do a lot of processing and be able to send messages across kilometers.
I have a question.
Another idea is that the chip will simply, chip will not process anything. It will simply look at all the bodily things and will simply send a virus
and compare it to the others.
No, also,
right. But wait, I have a question. We're talking about viruses here, right?
Would send
a virus to this?
No. The chip cannot do anything. The chip would be unmoving. It would simply collect data and collect data and send it to a database, and then the database can do everything else.
Right, that is exactly what
I have a problem. Let's say you want to sell a medicine, a very rare medicine that only comes when you have a specific situation.
Okay.
And that sells for like a lot of money, say on the black market. And if you can find a way to hack the chip is able to send it to the AI and it looks like the AI has seen as if this person has something wrong and sends him the medicine that costs a lot of money and you can easily sell it.
But I think there's also the problem that after the
instead of having the prescriptions sent automatically, all prescriptions are double checked by a medical professional whose job is to simply check all the prescriptions that are being sent.
But that would take some time. Actually, that would take a lot of time.
Instead of having...
What if the person's life needs it?
Instead of
15 minutes. If the person is going to suffer, say, something, heart attack...
Medicine that costs a lot of money that usually isn't extremely... is usually for things that happen over a long period of time. Like heart disease or diabetes, things that happen quickly and suddenly usually have very cheap medicine, because you can only sell so much to a small, you can only sell so much.
Yeah, I agree with that. But Ved's point is also right. There could be a case where, you know, the medicine is really costly and somebody hacks into the chip, sends fake alerts, and then, you know, that person, you know, is made to believe that he requires that expensive medicine. So, yeah, that is definitely a possibility.
So then we should try and use something
serious happens, a doctor will...
We could simply make it so that the chip does not connect directly to the Wi-Fi.
Yeah, it could be. So, yeah, Janvi, what was your point?
Mobile data.
Janvi, yeah. You were saying something?
Yeah, the doctor can actually, like, if there's something really serious, then the doctor will have to physically check it before giving some sort of a prescription.
Yeah. Exactly.
Either way.
Right. Okay. So, the key points that you should understand here is that, you know, we don't want literally a computer to be installed in a human body, right? We don't want that. We want only the basic sensors to make the measurements. We don't want too many electromagnetic signals inside our body. We don't want that. And we don't want a heavy chip, you know, this big chip to be inside the body. So this wearable device or the chip inside the body will do something basic. It will just take the measurements and it will just have the basic network capability to send the data to your phone here, because if it has to send data to, you know, somewhere which is like really far away, kilometers, then it should have that kind of network ability to send such a strong signal which will travel that far. We don't want that chip inside the body to be that sophisticated and that big. So we just have this basic functionality in the chip. The chip talks to the phone. The phone has sufficient hardware to send strong electromagnetic signals so that they travel and reach this central system. Okay, so there is a software inside the phone that would be converting the electrical signals to waves, and these waves travel in the air, reach here, then at this point again those waves are converted back to electrical signals. The machines understand it, store it in the software. Then you have software programs written here that study the data. So this central system is storing not just the data for this person, but for all people in the city through multiple years. So it really is able to store that huge amount of data. It's really huge, huge data. So when you do Google search, you are literally able to search for anything and everything, right? So obviously, you know, that data which you get as a search result is coming from somewhere. So there are servers which are actually holding on to that data. So you need that kind of data center to store that amount of data. And then you need to have, you know, softwares and technologies to be able to read that huge data, analyze information from it, learn from it. And then maybe this alert that goes to the doctor, maybe it just doesn't go to a doctor, but to a panel of doctors. And then one person is assigned the duty and that person talks to the patient. So this is...
Ma'am, it can be like a group of doctors, say like 50 doctors for a state, like or 50 doctors for a city or something like that.
Yeah.
Like they can be like one... Say, for example, sector 48 can be assigned one doctor. Sector 50 can be assigned another doctor.
Yes.
And then there will be regular updates to the doctor. Like, the doctor can check when they want to. Like, how is it going on in the patient? Like,
Auntie, can I keep my camera off? I'm going to eat in a bit.
Okay. Fine. Okay, next question. So, what does a smart city mean? Is it a city... Well,
I want to just point out how for the last 30 minutes we've been on one problem.
Yeah, but we discussed the smart city use cases, and pretty much for all the use cases, it's going to be a similar type of architecture.
So, ma'am, is it going to take a lot of more time?
No, it's not going to be. So that discussion is applicable to all the questions. So we can run through quick to the for the next questions since we have already had that discussion. Okay. So is smart city a city where all the important people, the prime minister, president, and other politicians live? Or is it the city where the most important business operations happen, like Mumbai in India or California in US?
How about none of the above for A and B, but the answer is C?
Yeah, everyone you overseas to point to yourself.
So it's a city where the infrastructure components are enabled with sensors that collect the important data, which is then transferred to a central system, which can analyze and perform critical operations based on the data, right? Like smart lighting and transportation logistics, etc. The healthcare case, which we just discussed. Yes, Sarim?
Ma'am, what is written in the meme template there?
Okay, so this guy is saying if, you know, smart TV, smart phone, smart city, then you all are smart people, is it? You have everything smart.
We are smart people means like and the smart people.
So anyone who has all these smart things is smart.
No, they're pretty dumb.
Okay, so the smart city will essentially have, so whatever the use case that we discussed, the architecture that we discussed, it will be something similar to that, where you are going to be measuring different things. Like it could be a use case where, you know, you're just automated the emptying of garbage bins. So whenever the garbage bins are full, then it's either emptied automatically or done manually. The person is sent there. So, you know, the measurements have to happen. There has to be a sensor which measures and identifies whether the garbage bin is full or half or whatever. And if you have a case of like, you know, the street lighting, so the street lighting could be the intensity of the lights or whether the light should be on and off. That would depend on the usage of the street, right? If there are no vehicles, nobody using that street at a certain point of time or on a holiday, then the light shouldn't be on, or the light should be dim when there is enough sunlight. So for any of
that these, that will make it much more suitable for our modern day.
Yes,
because like then we won't waste as much energy as we do now.
Right, we could save a lot of energy. So for any smart city use case, you need sensors to be measuring all the data. Then all this data going to a central system, which has the capacity to store all the data and analyze the data.
Did Google just time out?
Yeah, something just happened. I don't know what. The screen was blur, but I didn't see anything on the network. The network seems fine. I don't know what happened. Okay, so smart home and smart cities will fundamentally rely on wired LAN connectivity or network connectivity of generation 2G, network connectivity of generation 4G, 5G, or better than that, or no network connectivity at all.
Ma'am, I think this will be A and B.
Really? Why should
it? Ma'am, it is opinion dependent because.
Okay, why
4G do you think and 5G?
This should be C actually.
This should
not
be
necessarily.
See, we need
necessarily.
I was thinking that it should be C and D, but I read the no connectivity part.
Okay, for the option A, okay, take the case of your wearable device. Do you want to connect your wearable device with a wire to the phone? No, right? Would that be a convenient thing to do?
No.
I mean, it can be done. Yes, definitely. Long ago, we used to have only wired connections.
Ma'am, it is dependent on different things, like are dependent from object to object, like a watch that is not suitable, but like for a PC, it can be fine.
Okay, yes. Okay, so you're saying in some cases, but then you want your devices to communicate over large distances. You want your phone or PC to, like if you do Google search, you know, the server from which that search result is coming from is kilometers away from you. You know, it'll be really you know, logistically complicated to have wires between all the servers. So all that data is traveling in air.
Your screen.
Yeah, the screen was blur just now. I am not sure what is happening. I need to check later.
Ma'am, some loading problem or maybe Zoom is not able to hold the capacity.
Yeah, or it maybe something sometimes. Wrong with my network. Not sure.
Or something okay. with the server.
Yeah, could be. Okay, so in any case, we like, you know, wired connections might be possible for few use cases, but then it is going to be complicated if you want to connect and send data across kilometers to faraway places. So we definitely need good networks, wireless networks to, and you know, the data has to travel seamlessly, quickly, reliably for all the smart city use cases to work well.
Auntie, and also with network cables, there'll be so many cables that you won't get to know what thing is connected to what.
It's going to be a mess. You know, the kind of use cases yes. that we have in smart cities, the number of wires we will need, it's going to be super mess.
Yes, and even in the roads, there'll be wires everywhere.
Yeah.
Meme time.
And what if something goes wrong with one wire? Imagine troubleshooting.
Yes, the entire thing will fuse.
Okay. Okay, can a robot write a symphony? Can a robot turn a canvas into a beautiful masterpiece? Maybe. The robot is asking you, can you do that? You say you are human, you are better than me, but can you write a symphony or turn a canvas into a beautiful masterpiece? No.
Ma'am, actually humans can.
Humans can.
Yeah, definitely. But they have to have specific tasks.
Right. Maybe I cannot, but there are many who can.
It's like asking a formula racer to make a masterpiece.
Can a robot write a symphony? Can a robot turn a canvas into a beautiful masterpiece?
Yeah, he can.
Can you? Pablo Picasso, do I look like a joke to you?
Just a meme, but yeah, if you train the robot to do that, yes. And yeah, so some humans can, some cannot. Okay, in an ideal smart home, no manual key lock is required at a front door. The following security lock mechanism can be used. All family members are registered. They have their data stored already, like the facial recognition parameters, fingerprint, retina scan, voice recognition, everything. Once the person is in front of the door, all these scans can be made by the security lock system and the door will be opened. If the measured
parameter...
Ma'am,
part B will be so boring on the part of the person.
B is one family member will need to be inside to watch the camera feed. And open the door if they find the relevant person. If they find a relevant person on the door.
I want to point out how in the video, they did show being able to do this. But what if you want to go on a vacation? Or if you accidentally lock yourself out of the house while the rest of the family is eating pizza?
Quite similar to what we do today. Because someone stays in and opens the door.
Unless you don't have a manual key, which can be lock picked easily, I want to point out.
Okay, so yeah, exactly. Automations, I'm sure it has to be really good.
It would have to be A, because if they have their facial data stored, they can also allow us to add on.
So, yeah, so all these automations have their own plus and minus, because you know, unless it's really good, foolproof, and has
a question,
backups, it could be risky. Yes, Muktasir.
If I have a mannequin kind of head that exactly looks like and has the exact shape and measurements as one of the family members, will it work?
But wouldn't that be tough to, you know, it's not going to be easy.
How are you able to replicate its retinas? If it was a mannequin, have to be a biological thing.
Yeah, so you will need an advanced technology to be able to replicate all these scans. And yeah, so all these automations do have a downside unless they are really that developed and foolproof. Like years ago in my office on a weekend, once there was a fire, there were two people working inside the office when the fire broke out, and the door opening was all based on, it was a security lock system where you show your card and then the door opens. So due to the fire, you know, something went wrong with the electronic system and that door locking wasn't working. So they were not able to open the door. And the door was strong enough to open it manually. Finally, they had to break a window, jump out of the window. So yeah, it could be a risky thing unless, you know, all these cases are thought about and designed in a way that, you know, there is always a backup or some way to get out of trouble if the system fails. And what about this small guy? What will he do? How will he record his voice?
I'm a mud bomb.
So this.
So children, but the thing is, children shouldn't be allowed in the house. The parents should be able to open the door.
Yes, so absolutely. So this guy is going to rely on somebody who has access.
Until he's old enough or gets to the stage where he needs the door to open and close. If he's constantly going up and down.
Yeah, and even after, like, maybe let's say if once he's like 5 year old, you know, that functionality should be available to him. But then his fingerprints and retina scan and all those things are going to go through some changes, right, as he grows.
Yes, that's why they should keep on getting reinstalled for him. And yeah, he should be able to make another profile with him being older.
So all these factors will have to be
factored. I actually have been able to do this before.
Okay.
Downstairs, my lobby in my in the apartment, they have a fingerprinting system and a face recognition system.
Wow.
It's really easy to add your own fingerprint and face and unlock it.
Okay.
Yeah. I won't say how,
because many gymnasiums also they have that, yes.
Yeah.
The fingerprint system, yes. Biometric identification. Okay, yeah. So in a smart home, you can ask your digital assistant, the future Alexa, to, you know, questions like, what should I watch on TV today? And Alexa should be making a recommendation to you. How do you think this should work?
Should based on what you have watched previously.
Yes. And I think YouTube also, and all works.
Like if you could wear a wearable device and they could check your heart rate and from that and other details they could like assess your mood and all, and then according to that they could suggest.
Okay, something. So indirectly getting an idea about your mood. Yes, that could be the scenario.
Also, when you rate some things on Netflix and all, whenever the digital assistants, so answer C is also correct, because they can take your ratings and choose something which will be good for you.
Yes, right. So, yeah, so we don't have technology that advanced as of now to really read your thoughts and recommend a movie accordingly, though we are on that path, not for this use case, but you must have heard about the device, the technology advancement, which could make a person who has no control over his facial muscles speak through a computer, right? So anybody who had
Stephen Hawking.
Yes. So anybody who ever had the capability to speak, you know, and they lost it at certain point of time due to any medical condition or accident or anything, so they can use this technology to speak. So how it works is, like, when I have to say something, I think about what I'm going to say. I mean, it happens in fractions of seconds, so I don't really realize that I'm actually thinking what I'm going to say. But when I think, my brain generates an electrical signal for that. And that electrical signal is then converted to muscle movements, the larynx, the jaw, the facial muscles, everything, all these muscles they move according to that electrical signal, and that's how an audible voice comes out of my mouth in a particular pattern.
So one example is Stephen Hawking. So if he doesn't want to say something but he thinks of it, will he automatically say that?
I think so.
No, it doesn't work like that. So what Stephen Hawking does, Stephen Hawking can could have speak, as in he had the ability to speak, but he couldn't speak loudly. He could only whisper. So they used to hire a grad student or something like that, a person who he would speak to in the ear, and he'll speak to the entire crowd.
Okay, no, so I'm talking about this technology which is there right now. Okay,
yeah,
I am not sure.
Stephen Hawking also used the robotic voice.
Okay, so what this does is there is a brain surgery that happens, and then these electrodes are placed, and that machine is essentially measuring, it is taking that electrical signal generated by your brain as input, and you know that electrical signal is usually used to convert, you know, that is converted to muscle movements. But for someone who is not in control of the facial muscles, for them, this electrical signal is taken as input by an external machine, and that machine converts. So it's an AI technology where it uses that electrical signal to convert it into spoken words. So yeah, that's still there. But then, you know, we are still not at a level where without any surgery and remotely, we'll be able to read anybody's mind and understand their thoughts. Not yet.
Unless and until here.
Your Magneto. Magneto was able to do that, right?
And Magneto was able to use magnets.
You mean Charles Professor X?
Charles Xavier.
Okay. So we don't have a Professor X yet. Okay.
Patrick Stewart, basically.
Okay.
Charles Xavier.
So what we do have is something like this. So we can have, you know, our digital assistant can convert, can understand our speech. So it has the algorithm to convert that speech into words, and then it sends a request to all the accounts the user has, the Netflix account, Amazon account, whatever accounts this user has, and it sends a programming request to the Netflix, Amazon servers. The server
is fast, 1 hour and 30 minutes?
It's still 3:15.
Yeah, it's still 3:15. Maybe we'll just discuss the question six.
I was very confused.
Yeah, let's discuss half of the quiz in the next class. Let's just discuss still question six. But it was an interesting discussion. I don't want to cut it short just because we are running out of time. So let's discuss whatever we can in this class, then we'll continue in the next class.
Apparently, time is trash instead of money.
No, time is much more precious than money. Okay.
You can work for money. You can't work for time.
Money to get more time.
You can work for time. You work so much that you create a time machine, then you're practically working for time.
Okay, so
I have a question. If you use a time machine and you warp back to, say, when you were born, do you go into the body as you as a child? Or do you go as the body as you as an adult?
From movies, what I've seen, you can either go to the hospital and you will be you. You'll be in your current body and mental state.
Okay. It's too confusing. Time machine. When time machine is actually a reality, then we'll see.
If you aren't confused with time travel and quantum physics, you haven't really understood it.
Okay,
let's be honest, who understands quantum physics?
No, as in it's actually a thing.
No one.
It's no one at all. Out there. Literally a weird world. At the same time, everyone but no one knows. That's basically quantum physics.
See, these fields are still in their infancy. There is a lot more to be done, lot more to be understood, and so many scientists, many people are working on it continuously.
Okay,
Okay, coming back to this discussion, I just want to conclude this discussion, at least for this question. Then we continue with your point, Arhan. Okay. So, in this use case, what would be happening is, so this is the user, okay, like a stick. I know I am extremely bad at drawing, but okay, this person speaks to Alexa. So Alexa is receiving a voice command, then Alexa has its, you know, algorithms to convert that to actual words and understand, and then Alexa sends a request in the form of, you know, it's a programming software request. So you can have a software here, and then you have software at the Amazon Netflix servers. So there is a way in which you can send a request to the software sitting here. This software receives the request, and then based on an AI algorithm here, it finds a set of movies which it thinks this user might be interested in, and that could be based on what he has rated highly in past or what users similar to him have liked, right? There could be many factors based on which Amazon comes up with recommendations, and then it is sent back. And you know, these two arrows, they look very simple, but when you look at the actual implementation, this software would be communicating to the OS, you know, the network layer. So simple list of words getting converted to electrical signals, then getting converted to electromagnetic waves, those waves traveling in air, again reaching here, getting converted to electrical signals, then to actual words. So there are so many layers, each doing its part. Then finally, Alexa receives it, it converts it back to voice signal, and it responds to the user. So this simple use case where you feel you asked something to Alexa, Alexa responded. But behind the scene, there are a lot of pieces that are working together. Multiple softwares using multiple protocols to communicate on the network. Do you know what a protocol is?
Yes.
What is it?
It's a process which you need to follow.
Yeah. So it's a set of rules that you need to follow. So here I'm talking about network protocol. So when you send data onto network, which is essentially in the form of EM waves only. So for the software that receives it would understand this data only when it comes in a pattern, right? So like when you send a letter to someone, you put the from address, you know, at a specific place, you put the destination address, and then you put the actual message at a specific place, right? That's how the courier guy or the company which is going to, you know, transport your courier or message to the destination address would know. They would know where to take it, and they wouldn't open the message. The user would know where the message is. So like we have rules for the network packet also. Yes, Sarim?
Ma'am, the correct answer is C, right, for the fifth one?
Yes, so the correct answer is C. So that is what happens. The digital assistant will understand the verbal question, then it will convert it to a request that can be served programmatically to the Netflix or Amazon or whatever servers. So all the accounts that this user has. And then those servers respond with a list of recommendations. And then this Alexa again converts it to a verbal speech response to the user. So this is a use case of a smart home, and this is how it will be implemented. Okay, I think we'll continue with the latter part of the quiz in the next class. So we can just have general discussions, whatever. So Arhan was saying something, we can continue with that for the next 4 minutes.
No, auntie, it's fine now.
Okay. Fine. Anything else that you would like to discuss?